Welcome everyone to Defender for Cloud in the Field. We start this year with a lot of great things, and today we still have more great things to share with you. But before we talk about today's episode, make sure to go to the AKA link below and subscribe to our playlist within the Microsoft Security Channel. We have a lot of episodes already this calendar year, and a lot line up for the rest of the year. All right, so during Ignite, we release a very interesting capability called recommendation prioritization. And we're going to have this full episode dedicated to that. And no one better than the software developer, one of the software developers behind this capability from our research center, Aviram Yitzhak. Aviram, thank you very much for being on.
Thank you very much for having me today.
Aviram, this is a really great capability. I can tell you this, when I demonstrate this at Ignite, people really applaud. So first of all, congratulations for this awesome capability. Since this is your first time here in the show, can you do a brief intro and tell us what you do for Microsoft?
Yeah, sure. So my name is Aviram. I work here at Microsoft for about 3 years now. I had the opportunity to work on the amazing feature of recommendations, attack path, and some other related features to the MDC feature suite.
Awesome. All right, so recommendation prioritization. Although it could be like common sense for some customers, but for customers that are kind of new to Defender for Cloud, can you explain the problem that we are trying to solve with this feature?
Sure. So we understand that today there is some kind of difficulty for security admins to navigate through the vast collection of security recommendations that Microsoft Defender for Cloud allow today. Which continuously grow. We continue to explore different resource type and different possible security issues. And this list will always grow because, again, we explore different types, but also because organizations continuously change. They grow in the personnel that they have or the resources that they own for their production services or development services. And we are aware that solving all the issues sometimes might even look impossible because it's a long list of issues, and it's very hard to understand what is the most urgent issue that I should address today in order to make sure that my organization is safer and allow to continually develop the relevant feature or the relevant product in the organization while making sure it's protected and safe. So today we're trying to provide a feature that might help to remediate this challenge. And basically our task here is to provide a concrete list of the most urgent security issues. While all of them matter, because if they weren't matter, then we wouldn't show it to our customers, we still want to give the specific contextual information and the detailed picture that say, hey, even though you have maybe hundreds or thousands of resources that needs to be addressed, here are the closed list, much smaller list of resources that pose the highest risk for your specific organization. And we will show it later how we actually use the connections within your specific organization to tell you this virtual machine matters the most. And this is the first issue that you need to remediate today.
Excellent. I've been working with this product for a long time. I mean, since it was a prototype, and I've seen the different ways that we surface recommendation over the years. We were flat, and then we went to aggregated view, and now it looks like we are coming back to the flat with the recommendation prioritization. So what is the rationale behind that?
Yeah, that's a great context that you provided right there, and I can totally relate. Previously, we wanted to make sure that customers aren't overwhelmed from all of the different security issues that we provide in Microsoft Defender for Cloud. and can extract the most value from them. And for that, we basically aggregated our resources per security issues. So let's say you have hundreds of virtual machines that have vulnerabilities in your organization. And today we basically will show you a single line, and we'll see it together soon, but we'll show you a single line for all of those resources that you can later drill down and see each of one of them listed. Today we actually, in this feature, changing that perspective. And we basically say, we already know what is the specific resource that poses the highest vulnerability in your organization. And we say, this is a specific security issue and a specific resource that by solving that specific combination, you can mitigate the highest risk for your organization and basically achieve a lot more by doing a very specific and simple action most of the time. And this can basically help customers to navigate not only through the long list of recommendations, but also through the long list of resources within each of one of these recommendations. So this is basically pinpoints to the very exact issue that needs to be addressed.
Okay, makes sense. Now, when we release Defender CSPM, a lot of customers fell in love with the attack path, which I'm not surprised. It's a great capability. It's awesome. But there is always the question, and I think that now with the recommendation prioritization, this question will surface even more, is which one should I use? Should I go to the attack path? Should I go to now with this recommendation prioritization? Which one should I look at? Do you have a good explanation or recommendation on that?
Sure, that's a great question. Basically, those two views are complementary to each other in a way that they can provide a different aspects or different pivots of information the security admin can leverage and basically can use which one he sees fit. I would say that we always keep the entire product in mind while working on new feature. And as we will see soon together, we also correlate between the number of related attack paths in the new recommendation prioritization feature. And we also can see the relation between the two. And when we prioritize a recommendation and say, hey, this recommendation mattered the most, or this recommendation resource mattered the most, we basically, we also take into account the number of attack paths that can be solved by addressing that specific issue. And I must say another thing, attack paths are also prioritized regardless of the assessments. So they both affect each other, but you can also now open the list of attack paths that has exponentially grown in the last month or so, 3 months to be precise. And now you can basically address the most urgent attack paths just like the recommendations that we will see soon.
And how these things are calculated?
So I can't fully expose the entire exact logic, but what I can say is that we have an amazing team of security researchers that basically composed a very complex and interesting metrics that takes into account both the recommendation issue, both the security issue of the recommendation, like vulnerabilities of virtual machine, and also the specific organizational context. So if my machine is exposed to the internet, then that's something that I should take into account while prioritizing. If my virtual machine can access a storage account that has sensitive data, that's affected that as well. And we will see that soon that on each recommendation that is being prioritized, we will also get a list of what we called risk factors that basically can tell the customer, this is why this assessment matter. This is why this recommendation matter. And a customer can filter them and search them and even come up with some kind of a view that he focused on the risk factors that matters to the organization the most.
Awesome. Now, I think that one of the most important questions, because historically our customers, they also use Secure Score to measure their improvement on their overall security posture. How this new risk prioritization approach has any correlation with the Secure Score, if there is one or if there is not, well, how those things work together?
So we are also very familiar with the fact that customers indeed use SecureScore to show the organization leadership the current status of the security in the organization using Microsoft Defender for Cloud. And since it's highly used for our customers, and many customers track that and use that to reflect status, we didn't want to make drastic changes at the very release of the feature. So for now, by design, those two metrics are not correlated. But we are aware that for given since customers are really using SecureScore to prioritize the issues that needs to be addressed, we are planning to basically morph the risk prioritization for recommendations into SecureScore, making them correlate. So if you solve a critical issue, then your SecureScore will be dramatically improved in a way that is very visible to the organization leadership, and allow the security admins to not only see which is the most urgent issue, but also to have one single unified score that takes into account the risk prioritization as it being developed right now.
That's great news. Great news. I'm glad that we are going on this direction. Now let's go to the demo. I think it's time to demonstrate that.
Yeah, I agree. So right now we're in Azure portal, the one that you already know and familiar with. And here we can see a list of basically like recommendation categories that aggregate multiple recommendations into one category. And within each category, we have a list of recommendations. And for each of these recommendations, we have a list of resources. So here, for example, you can see that for the recommendations that says that virtual machines should have vulnerability findings resolved, I have 206 resources that needs to be fixed. And if I drill down into the experience, I can see the list of resources that needs to be addressed. And each of every one of those resources needs to be treated separately most of the time. So we're aware that organizations can have hard time basically to navigate through this long, ever-growing list of recommendations and resources, and to focus on the relevant ones. So if I click on this button here that changes the pivot to risk prioritization, I can see a list of recommendations and resources. So basically the view that we saw before is now flattened. And I can also focus on the relevant risk level that I can see here on the left. So risk level is the important part of this experience, because even though I have thousands of recommendations, as I can see here, I can also focus only on the relevant 52 recommendations. These are the ones that I should start with in order to make my organization safer. So let's select one of those and let's see why it is marked as critical. So again, this view is completely new, and I have a single resource here, as mentioned before, and its risk level. So this is a critical a recommendation that needs to be addressed. And right now I can see a list of risk factors. So those risk factors basically tell me, hey, these are the issues that made this recommendation for this resource a critical one. So let's see which one of them. So not only this virtual machine has vulnerability findings that needs to be resolved, it is also exposed to the internet. It also contains lateral movement, allows lateral movement within the organization, and lateral movement to resources with sensitive data. So although I have 206 recommendations that talks about virtual machine and the fact that they have findings that needs to be resolved, this recommendation is specifically critical because all of that risk factor that we showed right now. So if I click on the graph tab here, I can see a list of the attack buses that affect that recommendation as well, the prioritization for this recommendation. They're all listed here, and I can go through them and go over them and see the details. And I can also see some contextual information that is also available for this resource within my specific organization. So for my specific organization, that virtual machine has access through managed identity to a storage account. And this storage account contains sensitive data that is listed here. So a customer can basically go through this experience and understand the risk better and see why it is prioritized as critical, and understand the motivation of treating this specific issue first. So you can also see a list of attack buses here for each and every one of these recommendations. And you can see that there are risk factors that vary between the different recommendations here. So let's now go to the complementary experience, which is the attack pass one. And here you can see that I have multiple attack passes. I have more attack passes in various different risk levels. Some of them are critical, some of them are high. I have a lot of attack passes in this experience. So we are only seeing critical, but there are some other as well. And we also see an attack pass for that very own resource that we saw before. And this attack pass experience is also changed, because here you can see the risk factors that this attack pass is composed of. And those risk factors are only the risk factors for that specific attack pass. So this specific attack pass talks about internet exposure, vulnerabilities on that virtual machine that we saw before, and lateral movement within this organization to sensitive data. So basically, this will allow you to see the risk factors within a single attack pass. And on the contrary, the recommendation risk factors will allow you to see the risk factor for that specific resource across multiple attack passes or across your entire organization, even for stuff that aren't covered by attack pass, because on their own, they are not counted as attack pass. But within the context of that assessment, they matter and they affect the risk prioritization. Another cool thing that I will take the opportunity to show is the fact that we now also support cross-cloud attack passes. So if we'll click on this one, for example, we will see a cool example of an attack pass that starts with an internet exposed virtual machine within my Azure subscription that has vulnerabilities. Oops, sorry, that has vulnerabilities, but it also leverages access through SSH private key to my AWS account, which is a completely different cloud, but again, also covered by Microsoft Defender for Cloud and Microsoft CSPM plan. Defender CSPM plan. So basically, a customer, and again, this is our main motivation here, you can take the long list of attack passes that you potentially have in your organization and the even longer list of recommendations that you have within your organization and focus on the relevant issues that matter the most and navigate through the ever-longing list of issues that needs to be remediated. We know that the most high resource, the most highly valued resource that you have is your time, and we appreciate that, and we hope that you can leverage this feature to focus on things that matter the most.
That's amazing. That's amazing. I love the risk factor, and also the fact that this visualization allows you to see how many attack paths you are going to disrupt once you remediate. This is very powerful because it really shows, okay, this is the most important one. Once you remediate this, you're gonna disrupt all the attack paths. This is awesome. All right, Aviram, thank you very much for your time. Do you have any final thoughts, any final guidance or recommendation that you want to share?
Basically, we just really, really appreciate any customer feedback that you guys want to share with us. We really want to hear what you think about those new features. You are always on our mind when we develop them. So just a note to all of our customers that are hearing us right now, we really want to hear you. So we would really appreciate if you take a second to provide us a feedback. And thank you for participating in the successful private preview and public preview that is happening right now.
Absolutely, great recommendation. In talking about feedback, you can use many places in the UI. There are feedback all over the UI where you can provide your thoughts, but you can also use the AKA link below for our user voice and share your thoughts there as well, because we triage those feedback. All right, Aviram, thank you very much for joining. I appreciate, congratulations on this release, and looking forward to see this feature evolve in the future.
Thank you, Yuri. Thank you very much.
That's it, everyone. Thank you for joining. Don't forget to subscribe to our playlist, aka link below, and see you again next time.